I close the line, the row of interventions, and of course, most of the important, interesting things you already said, so I don't know what to say. Anyway, I'm Carlo Fossati, and my situation is pretty similar to Carsten and to Justin, because I run a space in Torino since 15 or 16 years, I don't know. And yeah, the first show was in 1999. And during the first year, I always had an interest, personal interest in sound and music. But the first artist I worked with, they were visual artist. But I remember towards the end of that year, I contacted Julius, Rolf Julius, and very soon he replied to me. He was a great person, so he told me he was interested in doing something together. And then, because of his schedule already very tight, it should have been in 2000, then it shifted to 2001, the show. And yeah, to help my speech, I want to show you a video which was shot of this specific show by Julius, because for me it was absolutely important to meet him, both professionally and as a human relationship, because we became very good friends. And through Julius, I knew everybody, Carsten, Bernd Schulz, Mickey Huey, Terry Fox, and many interesting, very interesting artists with whom I also collaborated in the future, after our meeting. Okay, this show, it was important, very important. It was the first, as I said before, the first work, show with sound. And what was really important was to work with Julius. There is one detail very important for me, because before the show there was a we sent email to each other, not emails, at the time I was using fax, also Julius was using fax, long time ago. And we prepared the show with materials at all. And when he came, the first day, he wanted absolute, he wanted, of course, the empty space, this is obvious. He wanted to stay alone. For most of the day, to stay in the space, to check the space, because he had an idea, but like always, it would change. Because for him, it was very important the space, to deal with the space. And for me, personally, in my personal opinion, this is one of his most important qualities. And so then he started to install the works, and it was very important for me to stay, because it had to be a couple of months, the duration, a bit less, but then I decided to keep it for a longer time. And so I had this great opportunity to stay several months inside the space, and it was a wonderful experience every time to arrive in the space and switch on all the CD players. And so what at first was a very visually very like perfect, very beautiful organization of things with the sound would become an organism, you know. First, separated things. With the sound, it was like an organism. And because the sound for Julius, the different sounds, in that case there were at least 7 or 8 CD players. It was a means to connect the elements of the show and to transform, to create a landscape. This is very important. And one, also another important thing I remember is, because we would spend 8 or 10 days together, I don't remember. He told me about his native land, which is northern Germany, very flat landscape, where he told me that if somebody were making noise like 3 kilometers, it was easy to listen very clearly. And that helped me to understand better his way to install his shows. In fact, okay, now you see mostly details, but sometimes you see the whole show, the whole exhibition, because the space we were working in at the time was very peculiar, because it was 120 square meters, but with no, more or less, like here, I guess, with no pillars or things, and very large, larger than this one, windows, and 3 skylights on the roof. So the presence of the light was incredible and always changing. So it was the perfect space for my our aesthetics project, and Julius' work did fit perfectly. Okay, here you see details of various works. A few of the present people know his work quite well, like Carsten and Bernd, and also Justin. You had an experience, of course, Mickey Huey. The funny thing is that when the video maker finally came to shoot, it was a cloudy day, so he had to use the spotlight. So it's difficult to have the right perception of this feature of the light of the space. Anyway, after this show, because I knew other artists working with sound, Julius introduced me to many, and with many of them I decided to make an exhibition. For instance, Terry Fox, who was not always worked with his sound, and Mickey Huey, of course, Christine Kubisch, and others. And there is a pretty funny story, because Steve Roden, who is a Californian artist, I just knew a few CD by him. He was in Switzerland in 2001, it was June, and he called me. He wanted to come to Torino to visit the show, because he was very good, big fan of Julius. He came, he stayed in Torino a couple of days, and we decided to make a show next year. So, strange that he was not a friend of Julius, but also in his case, it was thanks to Julius if we started a relationship. What I can say about static activity, as much as other people who talked previously, the range is very wide. It's not a specialized sound art gallery, not at all. I display also, because, for instance, in the case of Julius, Bernd Schulz told before this story about Julius, would say, I make music, not sound art. And also other times, we were talking a lot, he described himself as an artist, and using sound, of course. Because in the case of Julius, for me, it's very important his poetics, his vision of reality. And of course, he realizes this vision mostly through sound. Now I want to show you just a list of artists. Also Akio Suzuki, I knew him through Julius. And this is a strange case, but it's pretty strange, but it's useful for me because actually there was no sound. But for Akio Suzuki, this ANA project was a sound work. And I know that before this is 2006, but in it was in Saarbrücken, you displayed this same work in 99, I guess, 98. And in that case, Akio was not happy. And maybe you also, there was some problems. Yeah. But I was very much interested in this work. I proposed him to exhibit again. And he was a little bit unsure. And I proposed him something, but I tried. Because in the case of Saarbrücken, the curator should change the flower each day. Yeah. And it was a little bit too much, I guess. So,
no?
Yeah, he told me like that. Anyway, I proposed this time to create a group of people, all friends, and like 15 people. Each day, one of them would bring his own flower. And there was like a rite, a ceremony, let's say, because first the person had to take off the flower, all flower, one day before, to empty the vase and put new water with a funnel. And finally put the flower, but after having cut, because it had to fit in the vase. And so I proposed this system to Akio, and he accepted. Like, I was a little bit afraid that it looked too much my concept in a way, but for him it was okay. And then he was very happy after the results of this system. Then another artist I worked with who was a friend of Julius is Hans-Peter Kuhn. And this is the second show he did in my space, but this is a new space we are using since 2006. And these are large inkjet prints, and he chose photographs of he shot in Tango, this place in Japan, where he has a house. And then with Photoshop, he transformed in these colors. But the starting point, they were figures, you know, landscapes or things like that. And underneath the prints, you know, there was a space to attach the panel, and there were small speakers, so there was a sound. So this is an example, according to Hans-Peter Kuhn, of the relationship between image and sound. And there were four works. This is very long, like 9 meters, I guess. Okay, this another work by Julius. I will talk about it later. This is another artist, more recent show. He's an Australian artist, and he's a painter, and also he works with sound a lot. And so you see put the relationship, visual relationship between these large paintings and the sound. And this is a performance by the same artist, Michael Grave, in the same space a couple of years before, in 2008. And I like very much his approach because he installs a lot of very old equipment, like turntables, loudspeakers, radios, and when he performs, he moves around searching for, let's say, real sound. He doesn't work with pre-recorded sounds, but the sounds are coming from the machine itself, because he amplifies, for instance, the needle on the turntable against the turntable, so noises, and when he finds a few noises that they work together, he stops there. He creates harmonies, and yeah, this is another. And this is an example of an attitude I like very much, because all the artists I worked with using sounds, they don't use synthetic sounds, but they make sound with objects, real objects, or they record them, and then sometimes they manipulate. For instance, Julius was in the beginning recording noises he would like, and then he would transform with a reel-to-reel process many, many, many times. So at the end, it was impossible to recognize the sources, but it was a new sound, but created with starting from a real sound. And in the case of Miki Uy, this is second show by Miki Uy in the new space in Torino. Miki also records real sounds, and then she transforms them, manipulating, but with softwares, you know, through computer work. But you know, moral is the same attitude, but with different means. And in this case, the sounds, like very often with Miki, were tiny sounds coming from, for instance, the two sheets, drawings on the sheets of paper, drawing on the floor. There were small piezo contact speakers, very flat. And so it was to listen better this sound, the public had to get closer, like with Julius also. Julius always used very tiny sounds, and it was necessary for people to lean on the floor. And it was funny at his show, we did four shows, that adult people, they were a little bit shy, but then there was some children, and they were immediately went near the works, and so adults would learn from from the children the right way to approach these works. Yeah, this is a detail of the same show by Miki. You see this roll of paper. There is a drawing on the rear, and you see two speakers on both sides of the scroll. And this is the rear side of or front, depends on the point of view of the viewer. And this is an installation by the same artist presented by Nicole, Dominique Petigan. And you know, very clean, very well-balanced installation. There were four speakers. One, of course, we cannot see, but they were very regular in the space. And in another room in the space, there was another work with one speaker. And these two sound works would go together. So Dominique always established like a system. He works with the space himself. And okay, this is the fourth speaker. Loudspeaker, and this was the fifth, because this is another sound work. In this case, it was a voice. And in the previous case, it was sounds. So establish a relationship between sounds and voices. This is the third setting up of a work by Steve Roden. The first time was in 2002, then in a public space in 2005, and this is in 2007 in the new space. And very simple, but very, I like very much this work because he cut himself the bottom of the. A similar work was in Saarbrücken, but with many, many bottles, 100.
Yeah.
In this case, he did a different version, much smaller. And he would put like you can see, a loudspeaker on the floor. So the bottle would make resonances. A very, very beautiful work. And this is the first show by Steve Roden in the old space where Julius himself did his work, his show 1 year before. And people would climb to this very basic structure. They would lay on the platform and listen to this very soft sound, and more than one person would fall asleep because it was so relaxing. You know, he's a Californian artist, so his approach is much different from European artists or even New Yorker artists. This I learned working with him. Sorry? Yes. Yeah, okay, I come back to Julius to finish my intervention because, there were, one moment, I just show you this works. Okay, this is piano piece three, number three. He exhibited the first time in Märzmusik, 2006. And 1 year later, in his first show for Estatic, he did a smaller version because the space was not large enough. And he created also two smaller ones. Julius, for many years, he had a dream because he called this works scores because he created. they have a value, this, come si dice, graphic, they are graphic scores, and so they have a value of notation. He decided the value of the black, the value of the red, and also the shapes, the borders of each dot. And for a long time, since early 80s, he wanted to make a performance with Giola Barbara, a vocal performance. And this never happened. He managed to make performances with Aki Takahashi, the pianist, also Michael Moser, and also an ensemble, vocal ensemble. Who? Yeah. But his original dream was to work with Giola Barbara, who for him was the maximum. He was the only one, according to Julius, who would be able to perform this score. So I tried since 2006, I guess, 2007, I don't remember. And one time we were near to succeed, and we were almost ready. It had to be a place in Como, in a deconsecrated church, wonderful space with very high ceiling. But at the last moment, there was a problem between the director and the owner of the space. So everything was canceled, and Julius already had started to conceive the performance. But in that occasion, he would work with a video. And once with Giola Barbara was in Berlin, they rehearsed with this video. Anyway, in the last 2 years before he died, I tried a new path. I tried with the Castello di Rivoli Museum near Torino, Museo del Castello di Rivoli, because they have they had a room with very high ceilings, because you have to think that this score, it is 4 meters, more than 4 meters high, for almost 6 meters long. So we need a large space, and also with a very good acoustics. So I found this space in Rivoli, but it was very difficult, of course, to to find a good relationship with the director. She had to decide. They didn't have no money. I had to look for the money, and so. And finally, this. This happened, unfortunately, after Julius' death, because it was like that. And okay. Oh, again. Okay, this is the installation in the large room at Museo del Castello di Rivoli. And in this space, the score looks almost small, but it's not true. It's because it's really a huge hall, and you see the largest score on the back wall, and you see on the right these two works. Previously, I just watched for a second, very early works, and you see the other two scores on the left side. So Joan La Barbara accepted, of course, with enthusiasm this proposal. And my idea was, when we installed the scores, to create like a corner where she would perform, moving among the scores. Then actually, when she performed, she started with the first, then moved to the second, and finally to the third. She did not move constantly between the scores. And yeah, the thing is, this is another issue, important issue for me, because there are projects which need the right context, and there is only almost one possibility. And if you don't find this possibility, you cannot do the project. And in this case, for what I know, for what I knew in Italy, that room was the only one that could work. And so, to finish, I present you a very short, sorry? No, no, but it's 1 minute 30 seconds. Is just to show you what happened at the end of the process. One moment. Trailer. Open.